everyone. My name is Audrey Neff. As Kara mentioned, I'm the Director of Marketing for the Patient Now portfolio. Very excited to be here. We're going to be talking about, and let's timer just to be mindful of time. I'll just use my Apple Watch. And Kara or someone can just throw their hands up if I'm going over. So today we're going to be talking about a topic that is very near and dear to my heart. It is a topic I've been refining over the last probably 7 years or so, and it's going to be all things millennials. And we're going to go specifically into why. So before I start, I love data. I think it's really great for all of us to kind of have a gauge on what is going on in the medical aesthetic industry overall. So long story short, I'm not going to read all of these bullet points, but the big summary here is that the medical aesthetic industry is growing and it's not slowing down. It's a very exciting time for all of us. Like, how many of us are just so pumped out of our minds to be in this industry? Okay, I'm asking that again. Okay, if you don't raise your hand, you guys shouldn't even be here, seriously. Like, it is the most exciting time to be in the medical aesthetic industry. I think we're all in a really awesome opportunity for unparalleled growth for all of us. So a couple of reasons why this industry will continue to grow. We have low market penetration. Believe it or not, less than 10% of the addressable market in aesthetics, particularly facial injectables, has even been tapped into. Huge opportunity. Millennial opportunity and adoption. This is what we're really going to be focusing on today, and I'm going to tell you guys why. We'll do some data here shortly. Innovation, economic resiliency, and there are a couple things going on, but millennials is the focus. So let's first set the stage. Aesthetic treatments are elective. So the word elective means that a consumer, particularly a millennial consumer, has a what? A choice, yes. What do they have the choice between? You or someone else. Or maybe to not even spend their money on anything at all, right? It's elective medicine, retail medicine. Competitive, commoditized market. Consumer awareness and demand is up. And then we have that generation feeding market growth. So this is, we're gonna break down generational aesthetics, okay? And I feel like a lot of, for some reason, the term millennials, like there's just so many negative stigmas that come along with it. And for us who are millennials, we've probably all received that. I am a millennial. So let's kind of go through this really quickly. So boomers hold 24% of the market. And all this data is research that was done in my research paper that was peer reviewed for ISPAN, the International Society of Plastic and Aesthetic Nurses. So I'm not making any of this up. So boomers hold 24% of the, and this is North America data, by the way, 24% of the North America market. However, their market share is decreasing. Okay, Gen X, 41%. So they do have the majority of market share right now, but also decreasing. Millennials, this is where we'll stop for a second. Oh, I saw you kind of perk up back there. So millennials accounted for 22%. All right, so they don't have as much market share as Gen X, let's say, but they're the only generation out of these three expected to pick up market share. So when we talk about what are the three consumer markets in aesthetics that have full purchasing power, it's only these three. People talk about Gen Z, but Gen Z does not have full purchasing power. Gen Z starts at 10 years old. So we can just rule that out. Do some of them, maybe the older part of that group, sure, but millennials, ages 27 to 42, going on 28 to 43, just so we all know. A lot of people think it's kind of the younger 20s. It actually goes up to 42, 43 now. Starts at 27, 28. How many millennials do we have in the room? A lot of us. How many of us didn't know that we were a millennial until now? Yeah, some of us. We're all still holding on. So there we go, right? A lot of us probably didn't know we were millennials, and we are, and it's a cool thing. All right, we went through this. Okay, so why millennials? Prevention versus correction, and this is really goes back to prejuvenation versus rejuvenation, but in some cases it can be corrective if it's the older cohort of millennials. All in all, wider social acceptance, because they start aesthetic treatments at a younger age, they have a higher patient lifetime value than perhaps someone that is starting at age 50, let's say. So there's a lot of opportunity there. So what do millennials value and how can we cater to their unique nuances? So here are the five core values of millennial consumers in aesthetics. Convenience. And just so you guys know, on the last slide of this, I'll have a QR code. You can fill out a form and I'll send you this whole presentation because I'll probably be having to skip over some things due to time. So convenience doesn't mean that they're lazy. It just means that we've grown up in a world of technology. We have access to everything at our fingertips, right? Millennials are highly, highly educated consumers. Choices, right? We talked about that. They have a choice. They will do their due diligence. They will research as well. Experiences, millennials will pay more money. And I know that there's these negative stigmas that millennials are not brand loyal. They're always trying to find the cheapest in town, things like that. I think there's people that are like that in every generation. It's not millennials overall. Millennials will, statistically shown, pay more money with a provider in aesthetic medicine if they trust they will get a better result and experience from the provider and the practice. Authenticity and relatability, huge. So core four strategies of building trust with millennials. We're gonna kind of just go through some of these today due to time. This could easily be a 5-hour course. So we have, how do we connect with them? How do we optimize follow-up? We're not gonna talk about that today. Relationships and experiences. So in the industry, in elective medicine, there's actually only two ways you can acquire a new millennial patient. The first is you have a new entrance into the market. So this millennial consumer has never done any type of aesthetic treatment or procedure in their life, and you capture them before another practice does, or before your competition does. And the second way is you steal them. But it's true. Who do you steal them from? Someone else, person sitting next to you, right? And if a millennial consumer is thinking of leaving their current provider to go somewhere else due to whatever experience they are having there, where do they typically go to start researching to find a new provider? Google, the internet, social media, Instagram, we'll talk about tomorrow in my lecture tomorrow. So just some things that we always want to keep in mind. So this was, and Kara, do you have this in your, is Kara here? Do you have this? Okay. Okay, I'm gonna skip through this if Kara's covering it. All right, so long story short, and actually I'll just kind of summarize the study that Kara's gonna show in her presentation, but we did a consumer analysis survey with Google a couple years ago, and we basically surveyed 1,000 millennial aesthetic consumers who were contemplating cosmetic and aesthetic treatments online. And long story short, through the survey questions, the top two factors that increased or that affected their initial decision-making process the most, pre-patient, right, they're not a patient yet, were patient reviews and before and after photos. And Kara's gonna be doing a course on photos, so I'm not gonna go into that. But on the topic of reviews really quickly, actually, I think I have this in my talk tomorrow too. No, I have this in the other one with memberships. Yeah, sorry. Sorry, I have all kinds of slides. All right, so we're gonna skip through that and do some other fun stuff. Okay, I guess I just gave it away. What is the number one reason a millennial patient will leave a provider? What would you guys guess? An experience, yes. Whether it's result related, whether it is experience related, whether it was just a miscommunication, a horrible consultation, a horrible phone call, something happened, who knows what it is, it all boils down to an experience. And regardless of whether something is a phenomenal experience, top tier 5 stars, or a horrid experience, the common denominator between both of those is typically a person, right? It's a human being. So when we talk about human beings, and this actually goes back to this really cool graphic to this day, I wish I saved it, because I reference it all the time in a lot of my talks now. So there was this LinkedIn community I followed for a while, and I remember one day they posted this graphic, and it basically said there is no B2B, business to business, or business to consumer. It's H to H, human to human. Who would say that's so relevant in our industry? Absolutely, and it's especially relevant as it pertains to the millennial consumer group in aesthetic medicine. People want to connect with people, with humans, being your true authentic self as a practice, as a brand, as a provider, as a team. All of these things go a really, really long way with millennials. Personal notes. How many of you guys keep personal notes on every single patient that walks through your door? How many of you guys don't? And that's okay. No one. Okay, no one's gonna raise their hand to that. So if you guys are not, simple, simple fix, right? You go in to see Susan. Susan, oh my gosh, it's so amazing to see you. How's the wedding? How is your mom? Goodness gracious, giving her a hug, all these things. even if Susan doesn't know that you didn't remember her because you're seeing hundreds of patients, Susan doesn't have to know that, right? So going just a little bit out of your day, taking an extra 10, 20 seconds of time, jotting in the patient notes, a couple things about Susan, so when she comes back in 3-4 months, you can walk in there, scan the notes, and it just makes her feel like you care. Just these little things that yet take a little bit of extra time in our day. Also having a unique selling proposition as well. Okay, 5 minutes left. So a USP. So out of all of you guys, how many of you would say that you have a unique brand in your practice? Okay. So now I'm gonna ask you all this. If I were to come into your practice today, tomorrow, Monday morning, and take every single staff member you have into a separate room and ask them each individually, what is your practice's unique selling proposition, or what is your brand, would they all say the exact same thing? Think of that. If you're thinking, yes, I see you, sir, shaking your head, then you do have a unique brand. And for those of you guys who are thinking, oh, crap, no, I would say, actually, your brand is unique because you're the only one that even knows what it is, right? Okay, good, sometimes I don't get laughs with that, but it's so true, right? Every single person in your practice needs to understand what the brand is, but not just that, not just do they need to be able to articulate why your practice is different than practice A, B, C down the road, but beyond that, they need to actually believe it. Like, if they don't believe that your practice is the absolute best practice at loving and serving and treating millennial patients, and they're not bought into that, they shouldn't be a part of your team. And if we want to start talking about culture, everyone needs to be on the same train, aligned on the same goals, know what your practice's vision is, your mission. We all share the same core values. This should be a part of your hiring process as well, and firing, to be honest. But we all need to ensure that we actually know what our unique selling proposition is. Couple of sentences. I actually have an interactive exercise on this too. I'm happy to share it with anyone. So those of you guys who scan the QR code, if you want this too, I can absolutely send it over, because it can be a team exercise if you don't already have one. So if I ask you right now, couple sentences, what is it? And then everyone needs to know what that is. Okay, selling the experience. So when it comes down to experiences, we all need to realize that an experience typically boils down to perceived value, okay? So what is perceived value? So perceived value is the perceived benefit minus the cost. And this is, I will say, whether we are comfortable with using the word selling or sales or not, that's the industry we're in. If we are in elective cash pay aesthetic medicine, we are in sales. Absolutely. So the perceived, so in the consultation, heavily. Perceived benefit's gonna be more so emotional, I would say. So I believe, after looking through the photos, reading the reviews, sitting down with provider XYZ for an hour, her listening to my concerns, her educating me, things like that, I believe that if I complete this treatment series over the next 6 months, that I am going to attain this result. And because of that, I feel like I am going to be more confident, have a better social life, dating life, love life, perform better in work, perform better in all aspects of life. Right, the better we feel, the better we're gonna perform in life, regardless of what it is. So that is emotional, minus the cost. Okay, it's $5,000, $2,500, $10,000, whatever it is. The key here is that perceived benefit has to outweigh what the cost is, and that equates to perceived value. And 20 to 30%. Millennial patients will spend 20 to 30% more if they believe they will get a better outcome, right? So selling, because we're not selling a laser treatment. We're not selling tox, HA filler, whatever it is. You are selling an experience. You are selling the result, the outcome, the journey. It's not a product. It's not a treatment. And I think sometimes this can be a mindset shift where you can actually refine how you are educating patients on what they need. And who do millennials influence? So while They do not have full purchasing power yet as their generation as a whole. They are extremely, if not the most influential generation right now with full purchasing power. So I call this the three P's. They influence their parents. How many of us are millennials and influence our parents? Totally. Totally. My mom would have never, ever in a million years gotten aesthetic treatments and had I not influenced her. Parents, partners, so spouses and things like that, and peers, right? Three P's, highly influential generation. So while they have direct spending within themselves, they have indirect influence on other generations other than their own. So to wind it down, perfect timing, 20 seconds left. A lot of us have probably heard this quote, but I think it's very relevant. So people will forget what you said, people will forget what you did, but people will never forget how you made them feel. So relevant, especially when we are talking about today's millennial consumer group in aesthetic medicine. So thank you guys very, very much. Feel free to scan the QR code. Also, I have a really cool podcast. If anyone wants to come on as a guest, I can throw you on my guest list. I'm always looking for awesome people to come on and share their story. But other than that, thank you guys very, very much.